Dear colleagues, the most difficult and challenging area of thyroid ultrasound is the evaluation of lymphocytic thyroiditis. Anyone who knows this knows everything about thyroid ultrasound. The topic of lymphocytic thyroiditis is the most complex and most time-consuming part of the entire course. Indeed, the theme is discussed in two different parts. First here among non-neural thyroid diseases and the next among advanced courses. This lecture gives a summary of the ultrasound of lymphocytic thyroiditis. I focus here on the difference between a radiological and an endocrinological unit regarding the recognition of lymphocytic thyroiditis. I briefly discuss the various forms of Hashimoto's thyroiditis. The details are presented in differential diagnostic tables and case study videos. Finally, the issues caused by lymphocytic thyroiditis are presented. At the very beginning, it is worth talking about why ultrasound should be performed at all in the case of lymphocytic thyroiditis. In fact, the study should not be performed for all lymphocytic thyroiditis patients. Patients with a newly diagnosed hypothyroidism and a non-palpable thyroid are unlikely to get handicapped if they miss an ultrasound scan. Moreover, the performance of study frequently causes unnecessary further differential diagnostic problems. There are basically two reasons why it is still worthwhile to do this for all patients. One is that it is simply appropriate for a patient appearing for a thyroid order to clarify both types of thyroid problems, those related to structure and enlargement, and those related to function. The reason includes an argument that seems very compelling, and this is a common association between lymphocytic thyroiditis and papillary cancer. The other is that a patient being examined today will most likely have an imaging test that also depicts the thyroid gland during his or her lifetime. The patient is better off if ultrasound is done on an endocrine order. There can never be a better time to get a fair opinion in difficult to interpret patterns. This is because all the necessary data are available during the clinical examination. By later in a CT scan or carotid Doppler examination, the radiologist necessarily has significantly less information. And as we will see, in contrast to the nodular goiter, in the case of lymphocytic thyroiditis, the anamnesis, the laboratory data, and not infrequently the results of the follow-up examinations must be taken into account for a correct interpretation. And we have been already in the discussion of the first theme, the way of recognition of lymphocytic thyroiditis. It is worth realizing the difference whether a patient is examined in the radiology or in the endocrine unit. In most of the former cases, the diagnosis is made by chance. The patient was referred for other reasons to ultrasound or other imaging study. In contrast with this situation, more than half of the patients harboring lymphocytic thyroiditis are presented with hypothyroidism in the endocrine unit. One comment for the sake of radiologists. Except for patients operated on or underwent radioiodine therapy, almost all adult patients with hypothyroidism have lymphocytic thyroiditis. The second difference is in the opportunities in the two different medical units. In most cases, the radiologist can only rely on the ultrasound presentation. Three more diagnostic tools are available for the endocrinologist to give a correct diagnosis. He or she can consider the anamnestic data, the results of laboratory tests, and last but not least, he or she also has the special expertise. What is the significance of this in our daily practice? I give here the data of 113 consecutively examined patients who presented in a radiological unit before the clinical examination. First, let's see the discrepant diagnosis. The single healthy patient who was misdiagnosed as having lymphocytic thyroiditis was a very obese man with a decreased echogenicity caused not by thyroiditis but technical reasons. Four patients were falsely diagnosed as having nodules. Three had small cystic areas corresponding to dilated macrofollicles, while in the fourth patient an intrathyroidal vessel was misinterpreted as nodule. Overall, a third of people who turn out to be healthy had a misdiagnosis. Let's see those patients whose final diagnosis was lymphocytic thyroiditis. In six of them, the hypoechogenicity of the thyroid was overlooked. A radiologist is conditioned to recognize potentially malignant lesions. However, on the one hand, in contrast to breast, significantly much less discrete thyroid lesions share oncological importance. On the other hand, the basic echogenicity has a huge relevance in the thyroid, a feature that a radiologist pays much less attention to. Both in terms of occurrence and clinical importance, the most important discrepancy was the overestimation of discrete lesions of thyroiditis as nodules. Be aware that more than half of lymphocytic thyroiditis were missed or misinterpreted by radiologists. All true nodules were recognized by the radiologist, which means 100% sensitivity. Each of them performed excellently in what they were trained to do, to recognize potentially malignant lesions. On the other hand, less than 50% of thyroiditis were recognized by the radiologist. And finally, the positive predictive value was only 64% for nodules. It means that in more than a third of cases, when the radiologist diagnosed the nodule, was indeed a false diagnosis. And this is the very essence of the most important and most frequent problem faced by the clinician. At least 1/5 of all patients entering the thyroid unit comes with a false diagnosis, and many of them also require psychological care to resolve their unnecessary anxiety. The effort spent on this cannot and should not be saved, but at the same time it takes extra time. Now it is the time to apologize to the radiologist. I will present a few tables about the differential diagnostics of discrete lesions, which belong to another topic discussed among advanced themes later in the course. So briefly, there are different concepts about the definition of thyroid nodules. As many tools, as many definitions. In fact, the radiological concept prevails. The American Thyroid Association defines the nodule as discrete lesion, which is typically a radiological approach. The minor problem is that according to these, a 3 cm large isoechoic nodule is not necessarily considered a nodule. The much bigger problem is that virtually every adult has a nodule as defined by the ATA. I apologize for being sharp. And I'm very restless if it looks like I consider myself smarter than people who are indeed much smarter than me. But this definition is bad, useless, and in fact not taken by any thyroid experts seriously. Moreover, this is not the main problem. This approach leads us not to even try to differentiate discrete lesions. In fact, from an oncological point of view, only those discrete lesions count which are pathological nodules. And there are only three types of true nodules: hyperplastic non-tumorous nodules, the two kinds of tumor, the benign adenoma, and the malignant form, the cancer. This table summarizes and compares what we see on ultrasound and how it relates to pathology. There are five major types of discrete lesions which are not pathological nodules. The most important and most challenging one is the hypoechoic discrete lesion found in non-nodular patients. These hypoechoic foci are indeed more active foci of autoimmune thyroid disease or granulomatose thyroiditis. The second and far less challenging one is the hyperechoic lesion found in non-nodular patients. These correspond to those parts of the thyroid which are not or less influenced by the underlying autoimmune process or granulomatose thyroiditis. A macrofollicular is integral part of a healthy thyroid. The size of a macrofollicular can exceed 1 cm in diameter and appears on ultrasound as a dominantly cystic lesion. Small, coarse calcifications should not cause concern. The lesions of a few millimeters are not infrequently found in elder patients. Although subtotal lobectomy is not an accepted method of surgery since 2000, we will still meet patients who have undergone such an intervention for decades. In partially resected lobes, the presence of discrete lesions is not the exception but the rule. The surgical process, the scar, the change in vascular supply, they all leave a mark in thyroid tissue for a lifetime and appear also in the form of discrete lesions. So I think that the definition requires fine-tuning. The nodule should be used in pathological sense, and therefore I suggest defining a nodule as a discrete lesion which is neither a dilated microfollicular nor more or less active foci of autoimmune thyroid disease or subacute thyroiditis. Moreover, I suggest that the term nodule should be restricted for discrete lesions exceeding 5 mm in diameter. Now turn to the next topic, the ultrasound presentations of lymphocytic thyroiditis. Basically, the hypoechogenicity is the hallmark of autoimmune thyroid diseases, particularly lymphocytic thyroiditis. Diffuse hypoechogenicity is observed in 1/2 to 2/3 of cases. The more pathognomic presentation is the focal form, which can be found in more than 90% of cases. It is worth mentioning the 3 special forms. Although these can be included into one of the former categories, the special appearance is worth highlighting. These are the so-called honeycombing pattern, then the micronodular form. The 3rd is a less frequently mentioned and occurring subtype, which is characterized by the central large hyperechoic field surrounded with econormal ring. Let's look at these in a little more detail. Diffuse hypoechogenicity is the most well-known form of lymphocytic thyroiditis, surely among radiologists. However, this is not the most frequent presentation. The degree of hypoechogenicity varies, and this is in relation to the severity of the thyroiditis. Let's see some examples. The left upper image comes from a healthy patient. This is an econormal right lobe with a grayscale value of around 90. I remind you that the pixel intensity varies from 0 to 255. Darker the structure, lower the value, and conversely, lighter the structure, higher the value. The 3 other patients had lymphocytic thyroiditis and presented with diffuse hypoechogenicity. The left lower patient had a minimally hypoechoic thyroid, the right upper had a moderately hypoechoic thyroid. In both of them, the thyroid was lighter than the strap muscle running ventral to the lobe. The right lower image came from a patient who presented with deeply hypoechoic thyroid, which had a grayscale value lower than the strap muscle. An experienced examiner has no problem describing the images of the right as a hypoechogenic pattern. On the other hand, the distinction between the left images is a much more difficult task. There are 2 issues regarding the diffuse hypoechoic form of lymphocytic thyroiditis. Both are concerning in those cases where focal lesions are missing. The first is that the thyroid becomes darker with age. Around 25% of patients elder than 70 years present with minimally moderately hypoechoic thyroid. We may think that we do not cause a great problem if a mild hyperchondrogenicity is not recognized. Such patients are most often euthyroid. However, in some cases, and especially in young women, it may be important to seek to detect mild hyperchondrogenicity. In case of mild hyperchondrogenicity, the sensitivity of anti-TPO is significantly worse compared with advanced cases. We automatically recommend, even for euthyroid and anti-TPO negative women in childbearing period, a yearly TSH check and in the event of pregnancy at once. This will ensure timely detection of hypothyroidism and avoid miscarriage. Before moving forward with the presentations of lymphocytic thyroiditis, I demonstrate now with two examples the importance of the recognition of hyperchondrogenicity and the importance of its description on ultrasound report. Both patients in their early 20s presented with a borderline ultrasound pattern. Their thyroids were abnormal and had several tiny hyperplastic areas. Both a healthy thyroid and an evolving lymphocytic thyroiditis can present with this pattern. The patients were euthyroid and anti-TPO negative. I have suggested yearly TSH check in the event of pregnancy at once. A couple of months later, both patients were referred again for evaluation. The woman on the left gave birth 2 months ago, and the question was whether she should continue taking the levothyroxine supplementation set in the 5th week of pregnancy. In contrast, the woman on the right was sent because she had 2 miscarriages within 6 months, the second 2 weeks earlier in the 11th week of pregnancy. The TSH on the day before abortion was 8.2 milli-international unit per liter. Of course, it cannot be said that the luckier woman gave birth to a healthy child because her hypothyroidism was recognized, but the other miscarried because of her hypothyroidism not recognized at the time. Of course, it cannot be said, but by no means can it be ruled out, and in this case, the key was the recognition of a minimal degree of hypochondrogenicity that can be recognized usually years or even decades before the onset of hypothyroidism. The more frequent ultrasound appearance of lymphocytic thyroiditis is the so-called focal form. Up to 95% of patients present with this. I enlisted the main features of that subtype. I emphasize here that these discrete lesions usually have irregular, lobulated or spicated margins. So not only are they hypoechoic, but they also present with irregular borders. It means that most of these lesions would belong to the most suspicious thyroids category in all classification systems if they would be regarded as nodules. The distinction from true nodules and the issues regarding the differentiation belong to another topic. This will be discussed in the advanced section. I give only 2 examples here. The left case should not cause concern. The thyroid is hyperechoic and has more hyperechoic discrete areas. This is the typical presentation of a lymphocytic thyroiditis. However, if we were to stick to the aforementioned definition of ATA, we would and should have to call these discrete lesions nodules. The case on the right is much more problematic. Nevertheless, the shape of the discrete lesions, the multiplicity, clearly stand for being these areas more active foci of thyroiditis than true nodules. The first out of the 3 special forms is the honeycombing presentation. This is characterized by numerous hyperechoic islets separated either by connective tissue or echonormal thyroid from each other. The left case is pathognomonic. Although in the right case a cystically degenerated thyroid lobe seems to be a condition to be considered. However, thorough analysis reveals that these are deeply hypoechoic and not cystic areas. The honeycombing is a form that has no difficulty in recognizing or separating from the nodule. The second special form is the so-called micronodular or pseudonodular or pseudolobular form of lymphocytic thyroiditis. These resemble the former, however the discrete lesions are larger, they range from several millimeters to 1 or 2 centimeters. The discrete lesions frequently differ in echogenicity, however the econormal or hyperechoic form is more frequent compared to the usual focal form or to the honeycombing pattern. In contrast to most cases of lymphocytic thyroiditis, the thyroid is usually enlarged. In the left example, the thyroid is normal-sized. There are numerous econormal areas in a hypoechoic background. The right case shows an enlarged thyroid. In this patient, not the entire lobe, but only the lower two-thirds is composed of discrete lesions. The right case illustrates the differential diagnostic issue of the micronodular form. It is frequently impossible to decide whether these discrete lesions are pathological nodules or not. Fortunately, the differential diagnostic issue does not involve thyroid cancer. In contrast with the focal form of thyroiditis, this pattern does not cause oncological concern. The last special form is characterized by a central hypoechoic field which is surrounded with econormal rim. The latter is not always complete. This form usually occurs in patients with long-standing hypothyroidism. The central hypoechoic area has a rectangular shape, therefore the borders between the hypoechoic and econormal parts are irregular. The thyroid is usually decreased in size. Two examples. If we see only the transverse image, it rightly arises that these are hypoechoic nodules occupying most of the lobe. The longitudinal scan decides the issue in the left case. Note the infiltrative edges of the hypoechoic part and the rectangular shape. This cannot be a true nodule. The right case is a bit more equivocal, but again, the tail-like lower edge makes the true nodule a much less likely opportunity. Nevertheless, the distinction from true nodule is not always possible. The final part of the presentation focuses on the differential diagnostic issues of lymphocytic thyroiditis. As I have mentioned several times, we dedicate a separate chapter to discussing the first two problems, the distinction between discrete hypoechoic lesions of thyroiditis and true nodules, and the distinction between intact parts of the thyroid and true nodules. The third issue, the differentiation of hyperthyroid states, is discussed in the chapter of Graves' disease. Let's see the next issue, the differentiation between the two forms of thyroiditis. In a typical case, there is no concern about the presence of granulomatous thyroiditis. This has a very unique clinical and laboratory appearance. The patient suffers from unilateral pain in the thyroid region, has fever, and the CRP level is usually very high. In contrast to this, a patient with a typical form of lymphocytic thyroiditis has no neck complaint. The body temperature and the CRP level are normal. In a typical case, the ultrasound has only a confirmatory role. Let's see two cases for the sake of comparison. The left patient had a subacute, but the right a lymphocytic thyroiditis. The thyroid shows the characteristic hyperechoic area with ill-defined borders at the first visit, but the pattern in lymphocytic thyroiditis is characterized by diffuse hypoechogenicity and several discrete more hyperechoic areas. Even more impressive is the comparison of the change. The granulomatous thyroiditis shows an almost complete recovery over 9 months, while the pattern of lymphocytic thyroiditis remained unchanged even after 7 years. There are two issues. Firstly, the presence of subacute thyroiditis does not exclude the simultaneous presence of lymphocytic thyroiditis. Considering the fact that lymphocytic thyroiditis occurs in a proportion of more than 10% in women, we have to reckon with the simultaneity. This is important because it is characteristic of subacute thyroiditis that it heals without a trace and permanently, while nearly half of lymphocytic thyroid patients experience dysfunction later. To resolve this issue, it is worth following a patient with subacute thyroiditis until a complete ultrasound recovery, which may require even 2 years. The second issue is the non-typical presentations of the two types of thyroiditis. Less severe cases of subacute thyroiditis have a very similar clinical pattern to more severe cases of lymphocytic thyroiditis. Tenderness, subfebrility, transient hyperthyroidism are the same features. Fortunately, in the short term, within a few weeks, it doesn't matter much if we can't decide which form it is. In both cases, the administration of a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory and beta-blocking agent as a symptomatic treatment is possible, but there is no point in treating the hyperthyroidism caused by destruction with thyrostatic drug. Moreover, the follow-up of patients almost always decides the differential diagnostic issue. The ultrasound pattern rapidly changes in subacute, while is stable in lymphocytic thyroiditis. Now I discuss a special problem which affects the cytology. In a typical case, the cytologist has no problem in differentiating lymphocytic thyroiditis from oxyphilic tumor. Although oxyphilic cells are the pivotal in both cases, and these cells can present high degree of nuclear atypia, namely nuclear enlargement, anisonucleosis, and even change in nuclear shape, pleomorphism, an experienced cytopathologist is able to handle these difficulties. However, the concern is that a patient with oxyphilic tumor can have lymphocytic thyroiditis, either diffuse or focal form of it. The other problem is that the smear gained from lymphocytic thyroiditis can almost fully mimic an oxyphilic tumor. It is worth considering what the difference is if we have operated on a patient with benign adenoma unnecessarily, or if we have operated on a patient who has only Hashimoto's thyroiditis. In the first case, it is questionable whether one had surgery at all unnecessarily, since to the best of our knowledge, criteria that can be examined only after surgery to differentiate follicular adenoma from follicular cancer. The latter situation is much more problematic. We send a patient to surgery on suspicion of a malignant tumor who turns out to have not even had a nodule. In addition to operate a patient having thyroiditis is technically more difficult compared with a patient who has no thyroiditis. In the advanced section, I present some examples which demonstrates the potential of a combined cytosonographic approach in order to minimize the diagnostic failures. The point is this. Most oxyphilic cancer is a variant of either a follicular cancer or a papillary cancer. If neither the cytology raises the suspicion of papillary cancer, nor the ultrasound raises the suspicion of follicular cancer, then the likelihood of malignancy is minimal. Using this consideration, a substantial number, up to 30% of patients presenting with cytological suspicion of oxyphilic tumor can avoid surgery. In contrast to many other thyroid diseases, lymphocytic thyroiditis does not have a pathognomic ultrasound pattern with both high enough sensitivity and specificity. That is why ultrasound has a controversial role in lymphocytic thyroid patients. Occasionally, the performance of ultrasound causes more troubles than it solves. One would think that not performing ultrasound on lymphocytic thyroiditis would save us quite a few unnecessary problems. Unfortunately, this is not a viable path. If for no other reason, because of the problematic cases discovered in other imaging studies, we will definitely come across it. That is why it is advisable to start the lengthy learning process. I mention here two important aspects. Without regular sonohistological comparisons, we will not be able to improve the quality of our diagnosis. Thyroiditis is found as an additional diagnosis in a large number of surgically treated patients, so we will have plenty of material for comparison. At the beginning, it is indeed very difficult to distinguish between a more active foci of thyroiditis and the true nodule. I encourage the student to systematically review the ultrasound videos on the website, especially those related to thyroiditis presented in supplement chapter. This can significantly shorten the learning process. Thank you very much for your attention.